Hey guys, welcome back. If you don't know us, my name is Zoe and I'm a foundation dentist working here in London. And this is Ali, he's a final year dental student studying at University of Newcastle.
In this part of the educational series, we're going to be covering the examinations and special investigations that you need to know before you see your patients for the first time.
So last week we spoke about how to take a good history. So if you haven't watched that yet, we recommend you go back, watch that first, and then come back to this video where we'll go through doing a thorough examination and some of the special investigations you might need to do to be able to reach an accurate diagnosis.
We're going to cover extraoral and intraoral examinations, followed by charting and BPE, and finishing the examination with some other things that should be noted. We're also going to be talking about which investigations would be appropriate, and if you're here for anything specific, then feel free to skip around using the timestamps below. We're also going to include all the information summarized in a document with a link in the description. The document also covers the content from our last video on taking a history as well for completeness.
So the exam starts when you see the patient for the first time and you call their name in the waiting room. You want to be looking out for any disabilities, breathlessness, and their general appearance. The formal examination starts when the history finishes and you've received implied consent to proceed by telling them, for example, I'm going to start by having a feel around your head and neck to check for any lumps and bumps.
You start with the extraoral examination by standing behind the patient and palpating with your fingers on the TMJ, the muscles of mastication, the salivary glands, and the lymph nodes. With experience, you'll be able to pick up more subtle details, but to help you understand if something is wrong, compare to the opposite side and check if there's any asymmetry. There's certain ways you can ask the patient to move to make the tissues you're examining stick out more.
So for example, with the TMJ, you ask the patient to open and close their jaw while palpating right in front of their ears. And you want to look for any deviation and if there's a deviation to one side. This could indicate some sort of TMJ dysfunction. You also want to listen for any clicks or grinding. And if there are any, you want to ask the patient if it hurts. And if it does, then this is something you'll need more information about. Whereas if it doesn't hurt, I would just record an asymptomatic click, for example, in my nose. I would also ask the patient to bring out their lower jaw and move it side to side and look for any abnormalities there.
Then from in front of the ears, I would run my fingers along the zygomatic process to have a feel of the masseter. And as I ask them to open, then close, then clench, I would palpate along the masseter down to the mandible. Then I would move on to palpate the temporalis by asking them to clench again and placing my fingers higher up near the temporal fossa. The reason we palpate the muscles of mastication is because they can refer pain to other locations in the head, and this pain can be replicated while palpating them. They could also give us an indication of someone having a parafunctional habit like bruxism, for example, if these muscles are hypertrophic. And then when you later move on to look inside the mouth, you might see lots of tooth surface loss from attrition.
Next, you have to palpate the parotid and submandibular glands. And you can't always feel these in patients without any pathology, but it's important to still check them because if they're large and swollen, then it might indicate that there's some salivary stones there. You can find the parotid just below and in front of the ear, and you can find the submandibular gland just below the body of the mandible and above the hyoid bone.
You also need to check the lymph nodes in the head and neck region to make sure that there's no infections or cancers in the area, which can be spotted by enlarged red and tender nodes. The three areas you need to check are the cervical nodes, the submandibular nodes, and the submental nodes. It's easy to check the cervical nodes by asking the patient to turn their head away from the side that you're checking so that the sternocleidomastoid can be pushed out and the cervical nodes are made more obvious when you run your fingers along their neck. The submandibular lymph nodes are just superficial to the submandibular gland, so it's easier to check them both at the same time. And finally, the submental lymph nodes are most easily found by tipping the patient's head forward and rolling the nodes along the lower border of the mandible anteriorly. The last thing to watch out for extraorally are skin cancers like basal cell carcinomas, which look like red or pink, raised shiny waxy ulcers with irregular blood vessels and could bleed from any minor traumas.
If you notice something like this, then it's important that you don't just move on, and instead you need to ask the patient how long it's been there and if it's been hurting them at all. Basal cell carcinomas grow slowly over a long period of time, and a lot of patients just leave them to grow for years. So if you see something suspicious, you should refer them to oral medicine. If there's nothing wrong in the notes, I just write TMJ, MOM, SG, and LG, NAD. And this little circle means that nothing abnormal was detected.
Now that you've examined the outside of the head, it's time to look inside the mouth, and you start by looking at anything abnormal in the soft tissues, which consists of the buccal and labial mucosa, the palate, the tongue, the floor of the mouth, and the gingiva. On the mucosa, for example, you might see white lesions, which could be presenting from a range of causes, or you might notice bite marks on the occlusal plane, or even red lesions or ulcers, or loads of other stuff that you could pick up from oral med. But the important thing is that if you see anything you're unsure about, don't ignore it. Make sure you mention it to your supervisor or refer it to oral med.
The order I usually do this is first, if the patient is wearing a denture, I ask them to take it out and I ask the patient to open their mouth. And using my mirror, I start with one side and retract the cheeks and check the buccal mucosa. I then work around clockwise and check the lower labial mucosa, right buccal mucosa, and then the upper labial mucosa. At the same time I'm checking the mucosa, I'm also checking the gingiva as well. I then examine the top of the tongue by asking the patient to stick their tongue out. Then I look at the lateral borders of the tongue by asking the patient to stick their tongue to one side and then the other. And I check the floor of the mouth and the ventral tongue by asking the patient to stick their tongue to the roof of their mouth. And then I finish off by using my mirror to check their palate and the tonsils. A systematic approach like this will just ensure that you're doing this on every single patient and you're not missing any bits out.
Then you want to do an intraoral heart tissue exam, which includes charting and a BPE where you record each tooth in detail, noting down anything from caries to missing. And I would dry the surfaces of the teeth while I go around in a systematic order so that it's easier to spot any caries or well color matched restorations. Some people question the use of loops for the examination, but honestly, I love it and I feel like I can spot so much more of them on. In the future, we're going to be making loads of videos on loops, so make sure you subscribe so you don't miss any of that out. When it comes to doing a BPE, and I had to give one piece of advice, some people stop checking the rest of the sextant when they score a BPE of 4, but you shouldn't do that because you might also notice a focation involvement if you carry on. That would make it a 4 star. Pause now if you want to see how the grading system works for a BPE.
After you do your BPE, we think it's a good idea to also make an assessment of any tooth surface loss. So I suggest you do a BWE, which is a basic erosive wear examination. And you can pause here if you want to see what that is. At this stage, you can also check their occlusion, making a note of their molar relationship and incisor relationship. This is the bare minimum you should do, but ideally you would also check their left and right lateral excursions, noting whether they have a canine or group function. And I know this sounds like a lot, and most likely you won't be doing that on every single patient when you just start, but it's a good idea to get into the habit as early as you can. If they're wearing dentures, you can check their occlusion with and without the denture. And you also want to make a general note of the denture state, whether they're partial or complete, and whether they're acrylic or cobalt chrome. If there are any problems that you notice with the denture, then you can ask the patient more questions.
Now that you've done the charting and BPE, you use this information alongside the patient's complaints to decide which special investigations would be most appropriate for that patient. And here's a list of the main special investigations that you could do. Let's go through each one so that you can get a better idea of when to do them.
First one I usually think about is, what radiographs do I want to do? For new patients with no previous radiographs, you instantly think bite wings. If they have previous bite wings, you need to check how long it's been since they last had bite wings taken. The FGDP has guidelines on the intervals, and I'm gonna cover that in next week's video on radiographs, so subscribe so you don't miss out. For periapicals, the list of indications is quite long, and I have them on the screen now. I'll just go through a few of them with you. For heavily restored teeth, the rationale is that you want to get a better idea of the status of the tooth. Are there any secondary caries, any apical pathologies? If it's a crown, how is the marginal fit? And if it's an interproximal amalgam, is there a ledge? Has a tooth been root treated? Finding out all this information will give you a better idea of all the treatment that might be needed now or in the future, and you can warn your patient about them. For perio, you take PAs to assess bone levels and to be able to make a diagnosis. Taking a PA of a tooth that's non-responsive to sensibility testing might actually give you a reason as to why, because you might see some signs of apical periodontitis. And you always want to take a PA before any root canal treatment, extractions, or indirect restorations to help you with seeing the shape of the roots, the status of the periapical tissues, and to help you plan the treatment. And finally, the main reasons to take a DPT would be to assess wisdom teeth and their association to the ID canal. And they're also useful for any pathologies like large cysts and for ortho treatment planning.
You would also need to consider sensibility testing, which could give you an indication of whether the tooth is alive or not. And this is of 3 types. You can have hot, cold, and electric. The most accurate type is cold sensibility testing, where you would place a freezing chemical like endofrost on some cotton wool and place that on the tooth in question, as well as 2 adjacent teeth. The next most accurate is using electric pulp testing, where you'll be asking the patient to hold onto a metal electric conducting rod and placing toothpaste on the patient's tooth in question, and then completing the circuit by holding the EPT device on the tooth through the toothpaste. Again, you would test the 2 adjacent teeth as well so that you can see the difference between a possibly healthy tooth and a diseased tooth. This comparison is important because the patient might not be responsive to sensibility testing at all on any of their teeth because of secondary and tertiary dentine deposits. But if the tooth in question responds in a way that's much different to the healthy tooth, then this is indicative of disease. Just remember that this doesn't mean that the tooth is non-vital if it's non-responsive, and you would write in your notes, tooth non-responsive to EPT, as opposed to the tooth is not vital because the pop could still be alive. The last way of sensibility testing is with hot testing by heating a gutta percha point and placing it on the tooth, but this is hardly ever used anymore.
On the screen is a full list of reasons to do sensibility testing, and the same list applies for when you're testing for tender to percussion. When you're testing for tender to percussion, be careful of whether you use your finger or a mirror. Sometimes the patients come in and they're in excruciating pain, and if you tap it with your mirror, they might literally just jump out the chair. So with those kind of patients, I just use one of my fingers and I kind of lightly touch the tooth, and that would be enough for me to know that the tooth is tender to percussion. When you're testing for TTP, make sure you test some of the adjacent teeth as well, so you can have them in for comparison. When you have multiple teeth that are causing pain, then I would use a scale. So depending on which tooth was causing more pain, I would put an extra plus. Another special investigation to know about is using a tooth sleuth, and this is used when the patient presents with a cracked tooth or you suspect that there might be a crack in their tooth. There are two places you should be testing. One is the fissures and the other is the individual cusps. And the way you use it is by placing the pointy end on the tooth in question and asking the patient to bite down, hold, and then release, and asking them at what point did it hurt. The main signs of a cracked tooth syndrome is when they get pain on biting and especially pain on release.
Next is 6-point pocket charting, indicated by BPEs of 4 or persistent BPEs of 3 even after initial periodontal therapy, which by the way is supragingival scaling, OHI, and then an 8 to 12 week wait. You would also do a plaque score for any perio patient or any patient with poor oral hygiene. Another is taking a diet diary for any high caries risk patients or patients suffering from tooth surface loss, and then analyzing this so that you can give dietary advice when you see them next. Taking study models is another investigation which helps in monitoring the progression of tooth surface loss, but can also be used in ortho treatments as before and afters, and can also be used to assess space for indirect restorations. The last special investigation to consider is a diagnostic wax-up, which can help you visualize composite buildup cases.
Thanks for making it this far, guys. That was everything you need to know about carrying an examination with special investigations. Don't forget to have a look at the document in the description for the cheat sheet and other useful information.
You might enjoy other videos on our channel, so feel free to check out some of the suggestions here. Also, if you guys have any questions or feedback, we'd love to see that in the comments section below.
See you guys in the next video.